Artists began to arrive, sharing the community with this more established residents. As the century turned, Newport remained a free village. Its population, a mix of locals and artists. Slowly, word of its reputation spread, and Newport changed from a quiet river and canal community into a thriving artists' colony with theaters, restaurants, antique shops, art studios, and galleries. Relationships between newly arrived artists and the locals were maintained. However, many of the artists had bohemian views, both politically and in terms of lifestyle. In the 1940s and 50s, New Hope became known as a gathering place for both gay men and women. Over the years, New Hope has proudly maintained its old historic character. It has buildings that date back to the 1700s and 1800s still standing to remind visitors of a bygone era. The Bucks County Playhouse, known internationally, opened its doors in 1939 and was on the summer stock circuit and featured many Hollywood stars. Shirley Booth is seen performing at the Bucks County Playhouse.
Oh, darling, you surely know after all these years you can trust me.
A little lighter.
Lighter?
More comedy.
Oh, I see. He means more like radio. Oh, certainly, I'd be glad to.
New Hope has had many show business personalities as residents. Here's old footage of Oscar Hammerstein, shown in New Hope. George S. Kaufman also lived locally and is shown here after a Playhouse performance. In 1926, Phillips Mill began an annual exhibition of Pennsylvania Impressionists. This tradition continues to the present day. One of the most widely recognized painters, Edward Redfield, known for his snow scenes, painted this rendition of Phillips Mill in 1934.
He did nothing. He studied to be a portrait painter, but he had to paint what he saw, not what the subject wanted to look like. So he developed this technique of painting a picture in one, what he called, one go. That is, one day, he would select the spot he was going to paint the day before, and by daybreak, he would be there, set out with his easel and everything ready to start painting. And every day that he left, Mother Redfield was packing the lunch. And every day he would come home with lunch untouched. He couldn't take away any time from his first love, painting, or his second love, eating. I presume he was a struggling artist, but I don't think he ever thought of himself in that aspect. He painted because he had he had a wonderful garden, and Mother Redfield was a miraculous cook. She could make a banquet out of what would be thrown away in the extravagant era of today.
Edward Redfield was born in 1869 in Bridgeville, Delaware. He studied at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, sent to Paris by his father to study at the École des Beaux-Arts. It was there that he became fascinated with snow scenes, where he was painting in the forests of Fontainebleau. In 1898, Redfield and his French wife moved to a house along the Canal Towpath in Bucks County outside of New Hope. At this time, he became acknowledged as the central figure in the growing school of Pennsylvania landscape painting. Passageway in the center of New Hope, which is tied into the artistic history of this community. This alley was named after one of New Hope's most prominent modernist painters, William Lloyd Nye, who lived and worked in New Hope from 1924 to 1964. Before his death, he built his own museum. Nye's non-objective paintings were included in 15 years of exhibitions at the Guggenheim Museum in New York City. When Nye was not painting, he had a job as a night foreman at the local brick factory. Part of his pay was in discarded bricks, which he took home and used to create this walled-in courtyard at the Towpath restaurant along the canal. This restaurant was known as Cesspool Annie's. Previously, it served as a tavern for owners of the mule barges. But even before that, during the Civil War, in the basement of this building, a tunnel was built, which hid slaves, for it was a stop on the Underground Railroad.
Well, he was a true painter, been painted every day of his life for 15 years, mostly here in New Hope, some in Mexico and a little bit in Florida. And he was born March 8th, 1893, and he was an only child too. And he came to New Hope because it was cheap and beautiful, which I'm not too sure I can say the same today. I did hear a city planner on the radio say that the neighborhood goes downhill when the upper middle class moved in. He won a Crescent and went to Paris in the 20s and finally settled in New Hope in 1929. It took him 20 years to get past his academic training, and he really didn't have a great feeling for the art education he got, because in those days they used calipers to get the right dimensions of a face, etc. And my mother said, well, it would have taken him 20 years anyway to develop a style of his own. During the WPA period, he got a commission to do a mural for the post office in Youngstown, Ohio, and that mural's still up, and it's a handsome, handsome mural. Mechanic Street was the hottest street in town, and it was throughout my childhood and my children's childhood, with great music and great characters. And I remember my father would hang his paintings out. He had a little show going just out of doors on weekends, and these were beautiful, beautiful paintings.
Bill Nye was in the process then of building his museum and living in that area. He also at that time owned what is now Jeff Green's property, which at that time was called Pink Lemonade. Now the Pink Lemonade stand and whatever, and that started out as a restaurant, I think, back around in the 50s. Bill and I finally finished his museum in 1965. He also died in 1965. I didn't really talk with him a great deal, but knew a lot about him. And as far as my concern was, Bill and I was the most contemporary artist in this area at that time, and probably to some degree still is. He experimented on all types of materials and works in terms of expression. Some from the abstract routine later in his time to doing portraits of people of the area, people that lived here at that time.
The development of New Hope as a community evolved in the 1800s, not only around the Delaware Canal, but also because of a spring originally called Aquaton Spring, located several miles from the village center. This spring was a mystic and spiritual gathering place for the Lenape Indians, the area's first inhabitants. Aquaton Spring, today known as Ingham Springs, served as a summer retreat for the Indians, and its waters had the reputation of having curative powers. The mills which were established along this spring serve as a source of inspiration for the painters that began settling here, especially Robert Spencer, who arrived in this area in 1906 after studying with William Merritt Chase and Robert Henry in New York. From 1906 through 1910, Spencer lived in towns with close proximity to the Delaware River, including Frenchtown, New Jersey, and Point Pleasant, Pennsylvania. During February 1909, Spencer studied with Daniel Carver at Carver's home in Bucks County. One of Spencer's most praised depictions of working-class life is his Repairing the Bridge painting, which was purchased by the Metropolitan Museum of Art in 1914. Spencer lived and worked in the New Hope area until 1931, when he died as a result of taking his own life.
Center of the artist colony. Lathrop arrived in 1903. And he gathered around him a lot of people he knew, Harry Snell, Spencer, Redfield, and they would get together for teas on Sunday that Mrs. Lathrop organized and put together and ran. These were really the times when the artists were able to get together and bounce ideas off each other, get to know new people coming in, and they were just really the social time, social center of the community. He died in 1938 in the Great Hurricane. After he moved here, he painted, traveling down south. In 1929, I believe, he built himself a sailboat, a small sailboat known as the Widge, and he would travel up and down the East Coast, mostly north to Long Island, farther north, I think, up to Maine at times. But all summer long, he'd be gone 6 months out of the year during sailing weather, and he would paint. And that's really what he did from 29 until 38, when he was drowned in the Great Hurricane.
Morgan Colt was born in Summit, New Jersey in 1876. He was trained as an architect, became noted as a master craftsman, establishing his Gothic shops on the Phillips Mill property. He produced paintings and exhibited at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts and with the New Hope Group. He died in 1926.
There's not a lot of history information on Morgan Colt available. We have, over the 32 years we've lived here in the house that he designed and built, found that neighbors and frequent visitors who are in the area and have been here for some time have information about Morgan Colt and the family. We've been here since 1961 when we purchased the house, and as an architect during contemporary work, all my peers thought I was a little mad. But the house has proven to be a very interesting dwelling to live in. And all the little details and artifacts that are around, they're not totally discernible when you look at them. On closer inspection, you find all sorts of little details that you weren't aware of. And over the years, we keep finding them, and we still find some. The story that we have heard is Morgan Colt arrived in the New Hope area, coming up the river in his sailboat, so-called sailboat. I don't know how he maneuvered the rapids, but he got as far as about New Hope, and he managed his way to the Phillips Mill area, and liked it so much that he left his job in New York, and this was somewhere in 1910-1912 area, and settled here, purchased the property from the Lathrop, and started to do his craft work, his art work, his metal work, and the architectural construction work that he did. Colt, again, as we have been led to understand, was from New Haven, Connecticut, and the family part of the Barrymore group, who were the actors and actresses, and at various times in the teens and early 20s, the Barrymores were at the Colt property. The property in 1961 was subdivided by the owner at that time, George Green, into three parcels. Elizabeth Stewart and her mother purchased the middle portion, which is the Gothic cottage, and it, two other buildings, the Herringbone Cottage and Forge. The third parcel was purchased by the
details around the property are quite numerous. Morgan inserted Mercer tiles in many of the walls and the ironwork, details such as the lampposts and lamp fixtures, consist of lightweight metal that he designed and fabricated himself and put together as usable elements. Here we have a door made by Morgan Cole. It's inlaid with gold leaf and painted by Morgan Cole again with cherubs, angels, and dragons.
The legend of New Hope evolved around artists which began arriving in the 20th century. Today, New Hope has an international reputation, which started with the Pennsylvania landscape painters and evolved into the modernist era. Just as the traditional painting establishment was riled by the modernists and abstract expressionists, New Hope's art world began to split into two camps, abstract or modernist versus conservative traditionalists.
Because that Armory show in New York started the big battle, and then at that time the National Academy was held at the foreground, and modernists weren't having a chance. But as they exhibited more and more and more, there were more and more of them, they got the upper hand, and the critics and the dealers and all were jumping on the bandwagon, and the battle started. But as far as my husband was concerned, he was really very broad-minded. But my husband was invited to the big exhibitions like the Pennsylvania Academy, Carnegie International. He showed in all the big shows and took a great many prizes. He painted in watercolor up until, it was in the 30s, early 30s, we were in England. And we spent the summer in Cornwall. We'd go over and see his brother and family and then take off and settle somewhere and paint. And toward the end of our visit, his oils gave out and he didn't want to buy any more. Traveling by ship with wet oils is quite a job. So he went to an art store and bought some watercolors. And from then on, he found the medium so delightful. And when he came home, he started painting. And there was a freedom in the medium that he didn't have in oils. And he just went to town on it. And he took prizes right and left right away without any struggle at all. So how it finally developed was that he painted watercolors in the summer when the water wouldn't freeze, do oils in the winter. And I remember Bill Nye, when I was running the mill show, came in one Sunday afternoon and there was a crowd of people there, and he went up and took his painting down off the wall and said, "I will not hang my work with this trash." Well, it had gone, his painting had gone by the jury. It was in the catalog, but it was a good publicity stunt. I tried to stop it, but I didn't get anywhere. So it went. And then B.J.O. Nordfeld did the same thing when we had a little co-op gallery. There was a house in the park then, which is now the parking area of the theater. And we had a little co-op gallery there just as the theater was opening at the beginning of the war. And there were about 20 artists in it. And I called them the 20-odd artists. I was running it, and B.J.O. Nordfeld came snorting in one day, looked around, said, "I can't hang my work with this trash," and yanked it.
Nordfeld was the type of artist who came to Lambertville, Nimba Lambertville, which is really one cultural area, those two states do have, who represents the excellence of the art. He was a man with a national reputation who kept shedding his skin, not for poor reasons, the way Garber criticized the modernist painters, but because he thought that for art should evolve. The point of art was a modernist one, that is, the and he created great paint for Nordfeldt that whenever he would have a style that was successful and a gallery that would be representing him selling his paintings successfully, that he, more often than not, would change the style. Because considerations of success, financial success, weren't important to him. He moved here in 1937, having had great critical acclaim. His work was widely exhibited, got a lot of shows in New York, a lot of very favorable criticism, comparing his work to Morris and Hartley's, and sometimes critics felt that he handled certain subjects better than Hartley, certain shore subjects. There was no opportunity to sell much, particularly for someone like Nordfeldt, who part of his technique in evolving as an artist was to remove the decorative elements, that is, elements that people just responded to as attractive in an effort to get to deeper and the moment of the painting, as he described it.
As the modernists became a force to be reckoned with nationally, the modernist population in the New Hope Libertyville area began to grow. New Hope also began attracting many show business personalities and writers. James Michener grew up in the area, with some of his novels taking place here in Bucks County. Pearl Buck also resided in Bucks County for many years. As more noted personalities in the arts came to New Hope, the village grew as a tourist center, making it a weekend retreat for artists. It developed a reputation as an art center that rivaled Provincetown and Woodstock, New York, two other East Coast art colonies.
The modernists began with experiments by Charles Frederick Ramsey. Ramsey was always interested in avant-garde movements, vanguard movements. As a young man, his mother wanted him to become more academic. Ramsey also, in 1917, became the director of the Minneapolis School of Fine Art, but was fired immediately because of his socialist content of his inaugural speech as director. So he had a double whammy going against him at that time. He was both politically too far to the left, and he was painting in a style that the academies were trying to stamp out. So by 1918, the windows of opportunity for him within the classical painting world were pretty well closed because of his politics and style. So he remains a New Hope from then on, painting, but painting for most of his life with a very small audience. But then in the early 30s, a whole wave of artists came back into New Hope who had recently left Europe, who had come from America. They were American students who had gone to France and Germany to study with the modernists and brought back with them all the ideas of the avant-garde, both in lifestyle, but particularly in paintings. And when they discovered Ramsey, who was a generation older, they warmly embraced him as for what he had struggled to define for himself as a painter and the kinds of work he was doing. And he became the sort of the grand old master of modern painting to these painters who were in their 30s.
You talk about the artists in town, which were a great attraction to me. When I was a kid, I was invited to a New Year's Eve party at Fred Ramsey's. And Fred Ramsey's was one of the original founders of the art colony here. And he came to New Hope on foot. He walked here. He took the bus or subway or trolley, I guess it was a trolley, to Willow Grove, and then told me that he walked from Willow Grove to New Hope. And my father thought he was the original hippie in town. I said, "Why do you think that?" He said, "Well, he doesn't cut his hair. He has long hair like Christ, and he wears sneakers." And he said, "That's what I would consider to be a hippie."
Although the modernists had established a foothold on the art scene in New Hope and Lambertville, there were still many artists working in the traditional format because their paintings were more easily understood. Charles Rosen, born in Regenstown, Pennsylvania in 1878, became interested in illustration and moved to New York City to study at the National Academy of Design. Eventually, studied with William Marin Chase and Frank Dumont in the New School of Art. Rosen developed an interest in landscape painting, married Mildred Holden, and moved to New Hope in 1903. He became associated with Edward Redfield, and like Redfield, became noted for his snow scenes. But by 1916, Rosen determined he was no longer interested in landscape paintings, and began painting in a Cubist realist style. And in 1918, moved to Woodstock, New York, where he taught at the Art Students League Summer School. He died in Woodstock in 1950. The natural beauty of the New Hope area was one of the main attractions for the artists who lived and worked on New Hope's towpath on the Delaware Canal. Ray Sloan Gray, a native of Pennsylvania, settled in New Hope around 1915 and painted landscapes and portraits. He too was a student of William Merritt Chase and Frank Dumont, later taught at both the New York School of Fine Arts and the Philadelphia School of Design for Women. Ray Sloan Gray died in 1933 and was given a memorial service at Phillips Mill.
The modernists are different. By the time the modernists came to the area, they didn't come to study landscape painting. Those were the impressionists. When the modernists came to the area because the world already was an art colony. They wanted to be in an art colony, or they didn't want to be an art colony. And I think it's interesting that two of the leading modernists, Lee Gatch and L.C. Driggs, came here until they got married in the 30s, came out, and they stood at the Lambertville house for a while. And then they rented Robert Spencer's house, Robert Rund, and no one ever told him that he had committed suicide there a few years before. It's interesting. And they lived there, and then they finally bought a place in Lambertville called Coon Path. And Elsie told me, and I knew Elsie, and had many interviews with her at the end of her life, she said that she and Lee came to the area, and they were shocked by all these artist studios. They saw the studio lights and everything, and they really didn't want to be part of a local art colony. And they, for example, they never exhibited Phillips Mill. And they were represented by New York galleries. They just liked the area, and that was it. And Elsie Driggs, when she married Lee, she put her own career in second fiddle. She had already been purchased by the Whitney and had some serious exhibitions in New York galleries. She's at the Daniel Gallery in New York. And she did stuff with WPA on the kitchen table. Lee had a studio. She worked on the kitchen table. But then they both did post office murals, and they both painted on each other's murals. They worked together at the Lambertville train station, which was vacant at the time, and they laid on canvases and painted each other's mural. And during that time, Lee's reputation started to take off, and he was bought by all the major museums at the time. In the 40s, he was quite a lot. And Elsie's reputation had already been established in the 20s, but she didn't follow it up with major works in the following years. And then she had a baby, and that took her time, too.
My mother, on the other hand, who's Elsie Driggs, was a marvelous character. She was 6 years older than my father. She was always taken for Katharine Hepburn in the street, and I didn't realize until I had seen her in an interview that she sounded like Katharine Hepburn, too. Her mother came from the same town. So she just had this sort of radiance about her. My mother just loved to change. She didn't have my father's obsessions. And I think in a sense, it may have hurt her a little bit. She would do something and then do it as well as she could and then get bored. And then switch to another thing. Now, my mother was most famous really in the 20s as a precisionist. And of course it wasn't called precisionism then, it was called the new classicism. And it's very much how my mother approached it. My mother had studied art in Italy, and she loved the classical forms. And so when she went, got interested, which they all did at the same time. I mean, people think that my mother and DeMuth and Sheila were like sitting in an attic somewhere deciding to start an art movement. She never met any of them. They all, for some reason, started to do factories and bridges and planes at exactly the same time.
John Follansbee was born in Buffalo, New York in 1892. As a child, he contracted polio and was forced to use a wheelchair for the rest of his life. Follansbee began his art education in Woodstock, New York, at the Art Student League with George Harrison. In 1946, Follansbee came to New Hope, where he spent the rest of his life painting. Follansbee exhibited widely and attained many honors, including more than 10 awards from the National Academy of Design. He was represented by one or more paintings in each courtroom biennial between 1916 and 1945. He was awarded the third William A. Clark Prize and Bronze Medal in 1921. John Follansbee died in 1972. Studied at the Art Institute in Chicago and went on to New York City and studied with William Merritt Chase at the Art Students League. Coppedge then moved to Philadelphia, attending the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts. In 1917, she made her first sojourn to New Hope. Bucks County would be the artist's permanent home for more than 30 years. Coppedge died in New Hope on April 21, 1951, at the age of 67. Continue in the tradition of the past, not only in painting, but also in crafts and furniture. George Nakashima, an internationally known furniture maker, lived and worked in the New Hope area. and is represented in the Museum of Modern Art in New York. A wing of the Michener Museum in Doylestown is devoted to his work. Today, his daughter, Mira, continues in her father's tradition. Ben Badura, a painter who studied at the Pennsylvania Academy, was considered the artist most likely to succeed in his class. Eventually settling in New Hope, he became noted for his landscapes and achieved a national reputation as a frame maker. His wife, Faye, also talented as a portrait and a landscape painter, painted this oil of her husband in the 30s. The New Hope Lambertville area today not only rests on its past, but continues in the present as a thriving artist center, offering a wide variety of theater, dance, poetry, sculpture, and painting through organizations like the New Hope Arts Commission, founded to foster the contemporary arts and artists of Bucks County. The New Hope Arts Commission is dedicated to preserving innovative new works. It sponsors the New Century, an exhibition to celebrate the artists who live and work in the art colony today. The Arts Commission presents the New Hope Performing Arts Festival, which has gained national attention for originating work and has gone on to successful New York runs. The James A. Michener Museum was founded by this area's most esteemed writer. The Michener Art Museum was founded to preserve our artistic legacy and to present these images to generations of county residents and its visitors. There are other artists one could find at the Michener that are part of our area's rich history. Charles Rudy, a sculptor, who settled in Bucks County and gained a national reputation. Henry Snow, born in England, emigrated to the U.S., studied at the Art Students League, and came to New Hope to study with William Lathrop, and decided to stay. Harry Rosen, a noted sculptor and painter who moved to New Hope, taught at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, achieved a national reputation for creating the Connie Mack statue, as well as the sculpture of Jack Kelly, the Olympic rowing champion. George Sutter, who was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania in 1870. He was more known for his stained glass, where in Pittsburgh he worked for Horace Rudy Studio. In 1902, Sutter came to New Hope to study with Edward Redfield for the summer. Liked it so much, he vowed to return to live in New Hope, which he did in 1919. He lived and worked in Bucks County until his death in 1953. And Ralston Crawford, a Canadian from Ontario, born in 1906, who came to New Hope and was part of the modernist population. His abstract works gained national recognition.
In 1989, the facility opened to the public with an initial effort, and very quickly, people in the community realized that it was really essential to build a true museum facility that would be in keeping with the quality and character of Bucks County. So in 1991 and 92, a capital campaign was launched. A very talented architect, Lynn Taylor Associates, was hired. Taylor's office are specialists in adaptive reuse of historic buildings. And they designed a major expansion that would give this community a first-class regional museum.
The history of New Hope ranks the community as a leading artist center in America. Bucks County probably has more artists and galleries than anywhere on the eastern seaboard, with a tradition which continues in the community through patronage for the arts. Today, visitors to New Hope enjoy the vestiges of New Hope and Lambertville's artistic past and enjoy the thriving artistic community of the present. It is one element of this multifaceted, diversified community that is a common thread, a deep respect for the history heritage of the arts.